Hello everyone, myself Gaurav Mokwana, Assistant Professor of EC Department at LJ Institute of Engineering and Technology. Welcome to the session of Satellite Communication. In the last session, we have started unit number 2, that is Orbits and Launching Method, as per the GTU syllabus. So in today's session, we will cover apogee and perigee heights, orbital perturbation, and what are the effect of orbital perturbation. Okay, we know that the definition of apogee and perigee. Apogee is the point which is farthest from the surface of the earth, and the perigee is the point which is nearer to the surface of the earth. Now we are going to calculate the apogee and the perigee height. How? First of all, we need to understand what is apogee heights and what is perigee height. As these two terms are not specified as orbital elements, but the apogee height and the perigee height are often required. Why? Because the length of the radius vector at apogee and perigee can be obtained from the geometry of the ellipse. So if we need to find the apogee and perigee height, we must know the radius of earth, radius of apogee, and the radius of perigee. Alright? So the radius of the earth must be subtracted from the radius of the individual. The equation is RA, that is radius of apogee, is equals to A in bracket 1 plus E. RP, that is equals to A into in bracket 1 minus E. What is RA? RA is radius of apogee. RP is radius of perigee. What is small a? It is semi-major axis. What is small e? It is eccentricity. Right? So the only difference is, for plus it is radius of apogee, and for minus it is radius of perigee. This is the diagram for your reference only that we have already discussed in the last session. Alright? Now, we are going to calculate radius of apogee and perigee. Or, if the radius of apogee and perigee is given, we are going to calculate the height at apogee and perigee. Alright? The example is, calculate the radius of apogee and perigee, and from that calculate the height of apogee and perigee for the orbital parameters, which is already given. As eccentricity is given as 0.0011501, same distance is given as 7.92.335 meter, and the radius of earth, which is fixed, that is 6371 kilometer. We know the formula for radius of apogee and perigee. The formula is I is equals to A in bracket 1 plus E. We have all the values. Value of semi-major axis, value of eccentricity. So we are able to calculate the radius of apogee, and similarly for radius of perigee. So from the radius of apogee and perigee, we are able to calculate the height of apogee and perigee. How? The height of apogee, which is going to be calculated as radius of apogee minus radius of the earth, it is going to be explained with the help of this diagram. We can say that from the surface of the earth to the perigee point or apogee point is called the height, and from the center of the earth we are able to calculate the radius. Okay, so we know the total distance, that is the radius of apogee, we know that. So if we are going to subtract the radius of apogee and radius of earth, so we are able to calculate this distance. So this distance is known as the height. okay, total radius, that is radius of apogee minus radius of the earth, will gives you the height of the apogee. So we have done over here. Okay, similarly for tangent. So this is the height of apogee and this is the height of tangent. Now our next topic is the orbital perturbation. What is orbital perturbation? So the orbital perturbation is due to the gravitational and the non-gravitational forces of Sun, Moon or other planets or its different parameters. So the first point for the orbital perturbation is the irregular gravitational force around the Earth due to a non-uniform mass distribution. So it will this Earth's magnetic field to cause the orbital perturbation, that means a deviation in the position of the orbit, that is called the perturbation. Second, the main external perturbation can comes from the Sun and the Moon. Why? Because satellite is moving around the Earth. Earth is moving around the Sun. And because of that, there is a gravitational force of Sun, Earth, and as well as the Moon is also moving around the Earth. So gravitational force of Moon will be taken into consideration. Okay? So it will cause the stronger gravitational pull that caused the orbital perturbation. Third, the most type of orbit which is going to be affected due to the friction is called the low Earth orbit, that is the LEO. Why? Because it is nearer to the surface of the Earth, that we know that. Okay, the distance is 100 to 5000 kilometer, right? So the friction caused by Earth or the collision with the atoms and ions will cause a deviation of the low Earth orbit. Okay. Fourth, the solar radiation pressure affects the large GEO satellite which use a large solar array. And the self-generated torques and the pressure caused by the RF radiation. As we know that the antenna which are also going to be mounted on the satellite. So the torque and the pressure caused by the RF radiation from the antenna will also cause the orbital perturbation. And as described according to the Kepler's law, Earth is not perfectly a spherical. So at each and every point, there is a different centrifugal force around the Earth. Okay, so it will also cause orbital perturbation. Why? Because this force is supposed to balance the gravitational pull of Earth. So in reality, there are also other forces are there to play an important role to affect the satellite position and the motion of the satellite. Alright, so these forces are the gravitational force of Sun and Moon along with the atmospheric drag. So the effect of the gravitational force of Sun and Moon is more pronounced on the geostationary Earth satellite. Why? Because it is approximately onto the equatorial plane, on the equator of the Earth. Whereas the atmospheric drag effect is more pronounced. That means the effect of atmosphere is more on the low Earth orbit, because that orbit is the only which is nearer to the surface of the Earth. Alright? So, what is the effect of non-spherical Earth? We know that ideally it is spherical, but critically it is a non-spherical. So what will be the effect of non-spherical Earth onto the surface of onto the satellite? Okay. As I have told you, the shape is not as perfectly spherical, so it will cause some variation in the path followed by the satellite around the primary body. So it will cause the satellite to drift. It will cause a small change in the position of the satellite, as well as it cause the result in the regression of nodes and the latitude of the point of the perigee, which is the point which is closer to the Earth. So we can say that only this leads to a rotation of line of abscite, and this line of abscite, which is moving with respect to the Earth, so resultant change which cause the change in the value of argument of perigee and the right ascension of ascending node. Alright. So for the spherical Earth, and which has uniform mass, a Kepler's third law, which gives the normal denomination, normal mean motion, that is eta 0 is equals to under root of mu upon a cube. What is mu? That is a geocentric gravitational constant. The value is 3.986 into 10 is to 5. Okay. Small a is a semi-major axis, and eta 0 is a mean motion. So we can say that the zero subscript included in the remainder, which cause this result is going to be applied for the perfectly spherical Earth, which having a uniform mass. But the shape of the Earth is not perfectly spherical. So the equation will be going to change as like eta is equals to eta 0 in bracket 1 plus k1, that k1 is a constant, in bracket 1 minus 1.5 sin square I. What is I? I is the inclination angle, divided by semi-major axis, a square in bracket 1 minus e square raised to 1.5. Then what is small e? Small e stands for eccentricity. Alright, so we can say that the Earth is not perfectly spherical, so we can cause, it can cause the equatorial bulge and the flattening at the poles. So it is known as the shape of the Earth, which is called the oblate sphere. As I have told you, k1 is a constant, and this Earth's oblate has a negligible effect on the semi-major axis. Alright? So we can say the anomalistic period PA is equals to 2 pi upon n. Now let's take one example. A satellite is orbiting in the equatorial plane with the period, which has a perigee to perigee is 12 hours. So eccentricity is given. We need to calculate the semi-major axis. We know that eta is equals to 2 pi upon p. From the period p is equals to 12 hours, we are able to calculate the mean motion. So from this mean motion, we are able to calculate from the Kepler's third law the value of semi-major axis, that is mu upon eta square raised to 1 by 3. Alright? The value of mu is constant, and the eta that we have already calculated. Alright? So we are getting the value of semi-major axis, that is 26,612 km. Now what is atmospheric drag? We know that it is more pronounced for the LEO, right? So this impact of drag is maximum at the point of perigee. It will cause a drag, that means a pull towards the Earth has an effect on the velocity of satellite. So at the perigee point, the velocity of satellite will going to be reduced because of the atmospheric drag. So it will cause the satellite to not to reach the apogee height at successive revolution. So it will cause the change in the semi-major axis and the eccentricity. These are the references which I have taken. So over here, unit number 2 is finished. In the next session, we are going to start unit number 3, that is a geostationary orbit. Alright, but still if you have any question, you can ask me at any time when you are ready. Till then, thank you for your attention.